Hi, I'm Ivy Zhuang. I am a software engineer from gRPC team at Google. I have been in cloud industry for 5 years, and now I work on gRPC Java open source and proxyless service mesh.
And I'm Richard Belleville. I'm a senior software engineer on the gRPC team at Google. I'm the tech lead for the Python bindings, but I also do a lot of miscellaneous work relating to gRPC, including on gRPC proxyless service mesh, which is the focus of this talk. Before going over the story of how service mesh evolved, let's give a brief overview of how the term is understood today. If you put five service mesh thought leaders in the same room, you're going to get five different definitions of service mesh out of them. So bear that in mind. But for now, we're going to define service mesh as this: a collection of horizontally scaled microservices whose nodes are connected by network infrastructure that manages the connectivity between them. This is pretty abstract, but it will make more sense as we go on. At this point, I think it's likely that you've all heard about microservices. The classical software system was a monolith. All functionality written into a single code base in a single language, compiled into a single binary, and deployed to some VMware hypervisor somewhere, and if you're lucky, it has a backup for redundancy. But this was brittle. A bad change by a team you've never heard of can cause a rollback or delay of a feature you've been trying to deploy for months. So for that reason, and many others, individual teams began to proclaim their independence and break out smaller services owned exclusively by their own team, which interoperated with the rest of the system via APIs exposed over the network, like gRPC or REST or one of many other solutions. While breaking things into microservices made some things easier, it also made others harder. Calling a networked API has quite a few more considerations than a local function call. Above, you can see a simple diagram of a web-based shopping app. You've got a cart microservice and an account microservice, and they're both distributed across two different regions for redundancy. So, how does the green client here know where to send a request for the account service? There are four different account services here on this slide. Which one gets the request? Sometimes backends go down and you want to stop sending requests to those particular backends. Here, you can see that the whole US West 1 region went down. Now, the client should redirect the requests to US East 2. Sometimes you may want a client to split its traffic in some distribution other than an even split. Maybe you've got beefier machines in US West 1 and want them to shoulder more of the burden. DNS on its own isn't sufficient to solve the failure problem or the traffic waiting problem. So companies began to write libraries wrapping their networked API calls to enforce cross-cutting policies like this. You'll see here that the yellow network policy library runs in the same process as the client application, and it is responsible for actually making the networked calls. This can work remarkably well. But microservices also give you the freedom to write your code in any language you want. And a company using microservices generally ends up actively using quite a few languages all at once, even if they started out using just a single one. Maintaining a library like that for many languages and making sure that the behavior is consistent across all of them is not an easy task. That's exactly what we on the gRPC team do every day: keep a single library consistent across a huge matrix of supported languages. So instead of re-implementing that library four or five times, once for each language in the company, platform teams began to pull that library out into a separate process co-located with the client that non-invasively intercepts traffic and enforces the appropriate policies. These were the first sidecar proxies. With sidecar proxies, it no longer mattered what language you wrote your policies in. Any client could take advantage of it: Go, Java, Python, C#. Eventually, standardized configurable sidecar proxies started being introduced, Envoy and Linkerd being two popular examples. These allowed you to express your policies via configuration instead of code. Finally, the last building block of the service mesh went in: a control plane. At first, it seemed like a convenience feature: phone home to a central server for this sidecar configuration instead of having to place it on the file system of every single client. But people soon realized it could be used for much more than that. With a control plane, you have the ability to dynamically change the behavior of your system from a central location, perform a phased rollout by slowly changing the traffic split from one set of backends to another, perform global traffic optimization by collecting load report stats from your whole fleet of sidecars. And that brings us to today. Linkerd stopped calling itself a proxy and started calling itself a service mesh. Various Envoy-based service meshes proliferated, like Istio or GCP's Traffic Director. People continued with their sidecar proxies, happy with the newfound flexibility for a while, but some people started taking a look at their cloud provider bills and weren't so happy with what they saw. It turns out that sidecar proxies, no matter how good they are, generally have to copy the data from the payload at least once. This injects latency into the request, and it eats up CPU. So some people began seeking out ways to eliminate the sidecar proxy from their system. And that's where gRPC enters the picture. So I'll turn it over to Ivy to tell you about that.
Moving from a sidecar proxy to gRP proxyless service mesh comes with many benefits. Eliminate the complexity of deploying the sidecar and managing its lifecycle. Gain better performance by saving the cost of running a proxy, removing potential bottlenecks. Achieve end-to-end security by closing the gap of last-mile security concerns between the proxy and the application. Besides that, you enjoy all the benefits of the existing gRPC functionality. Fast streaming, high performance and efficiency, rich features like deadline, cancellation, and metadata, availability in multiple languages, easy backward-forward compatibility with protocol buffers, high industry adoption, and a strong community support. Last but not the least, gRPC uses an open standard API xDS to talk to the control plane. As a client library, it is compatible with any control plane speak xDS. Now let's go through a quick overview of gRPC service mesh. Building a service mesh means using a management infrastructure, the control plane, for central configuration. For example, GCP's traffic director is the Google managed control plane to configure traffic management, security, scalability, and resiliency for your service mesh. On the right side of the picture, the data plane receives the configuration, runs microservices, and forms a service mesh. Inside the data plane, instead of running a fleet of sidecar proxies in each of the microservice hosts, gRPC supports proxyless service mesh. It combines both the network abstract layer and the RPC system into the same client library. This way, you do not have to deploy a sidecar proxy and it serves the same need. The microservices can scale up and down and talk to each other the way you want. gRPC is providing a growing number of significant features. At the core, gRPC service mesh resolves endpoint addresses and routes the traffic between your microservices. Name resolution and resource discovery results form a hierarchy of load balancers with high-grained capability to configure request routing. Even better, we recently started supporting custom load balancing, which allows you to bring your own load balancing policy and plug into gRPC. As an enhancement, we support OCAP, which allows you to inject metrics from a gRPC server and consume them in the data plane LB policy. This allows you to write your own sophisticated load balancing algorithms using the metric feedbacks. gRPC has strong security support. You can centrally manage access between workloads using client authorization and mutual TOS in GKE. We're excited to announce that we have launched gRPC observability recently. It supports metrics, tracing, logging, alerts and notifications. All these make it very easy for monitoring, developments, and debugging. gRPC brings new capability to improve the reliability, availability, and efficiency for your microservices. Circuit breaking can be used to control the maximum number of simultaneous RPCs allowed from each client to your service. This helps prevent excessive load. Fault injection provides a way to test the resiliency of microservices in the presence of different types of failures. With this feature, you can artificially delay or fail a percentage of RPCs to determine how well your system handles these scenarios before they happen due to a real production event. Maximum stream duration or timeout allows you to configure time limits for all RPCs within the mesh. It ensures clients abort operations that are running unusually slow where it is unlikely they will succeed, enabling them to try another backend or report an error more quickly. Retry can very efficiently improve your service availability. When enabled, gRPC applications will retry the outbound requests according to a configured policy. This can be helpful if instances or endpoints are slow or flaky. Outlier detection is another feature to improve network resiliency. The client checks the success rate of requests made to each backend. And when backends have unusually low success rate over a period of time compared to others in the same cluster, the client temporarily stops sending requests to that backend. With that, I will hand it back to Richard to put some perspective on gRPC proxyless, and then talk about who is using gRPC proxyless and how.
Now, when I told you that people started looking to eliminate sidecars, of course, gRPC proxyless was not the only potential solution people came up with. The other proxyless or sidecarless service mesh data plane that has been getting a lot of buzz recently, particularly in the Kubernetes community, is eBPF. Both gRPC and eBPF sell themselves as providing service mesh without sidecar proxies, but they're not exactly the same thing. For starters, of course, gRPC runs in user space, compiled into the same binary as your application, while eBPF runs in a secure virtual machine in the kernel. Neither of these models is clearly a win over the other. The lack of repeated hopping between user space and kernel space makes both gRPC proxyless and eBPF faster than sidecars. gRPC proxyless doesn't need to parse outgoing requests to make routing decisions, while eBPF must do this since it doesn't cooperate with the application crafting the requests. In practice, eBPF today often actually does require cooperation with the sidecar. This is used for things like communication with the control plane. eBPF is non-invasive in the sense that you can take some legacy binary that hasn't been recompiled in 20 years and add eBPF instrumentation. Whereas with gRPC proxyless, you have to compile library support in. But that comes at a cost. eBPF loses out on some application layer features like path matching, header matching, and certain forms of traffic splitting. gRPC proxyless rots at the level of gRPC, so it's able to handle all of those. eBPF, on the other hand, currently only rots at the level of TCP and UDP. Of course, eBPF is evolving, so some of this may change over time, but today, gRPC proxyless service mesh is still the most efficient way to route gRPC traffic in your distributed system. One of the most active areas of recent development in the Kubernetes sphere is the gateway APIs. These are sort of a revamp to the ingress resource. Over the past year or so, work has been ongoing to integrate gRPC with these APIs so that you can route gRPC traffic idiomatically rather than having to do it at the level of HTTP. That resource, gRPC route, is now in the experimental stream of the gateway API repo. Support for it will be making it into Traffic Director on GCP soon, and support in many other controllers will follow soon after. The other really exciting thing in this space is Gamma, usage of the gateway APIs to manage not just ingress, but also service mesh use cases. It's still early days with that effort, but we are deeply engaged in the design process to ensure that gRPC and proxyless service mesh have first-class support in the APIs. Be on the lookout for the ability to configure gRPC proxyless service mesh using 100% vendor-agnostic upstream Kubernetes resources. Industry leaders are choosing gRPC proxyless service mesh to make their systems faster, more efficient, and more resilient. Proxyless service meshes in general have been in use at very large tech companies like Google for years. gRPC proxyless service mesh on GCP is now democratizing that capability and making it easy for smaller organizations to switch to the proxyless model. Those who adopted gRPC proxyless are already seeing a decrease in their compute usage and a decrease in the latency of requests through their systems. We believe a large fraction of service mesh operators will adopt proxyless service mesh in one form or another as the gains it brings people become known more and more widely.
Thanks for watching. Go ahead and try out the user guide to build your next generation service mesh.